Thanks everybody for being here. I'm pleased to be acting as chairman today. And this is the first online seminar of the Center for Complexity and Biosystems. We hope that we will go back to the normal seminars someday soon. But for now, we will move to online seminars. And we're happy that so many people is joining today. We're happy to see some of our old and still present collaborators with us, and we hope to at least reach a wider audience with this new format. So just a couple of instructions. Try to keep your microphone muted during the seminar. And if you want, it's also nice to keep your camera on so that we see that you're still there. A suggestion, of course. If you have questions, I think it's better if you hold them till the end, and we will have a big discussion, and we have a lot of time, of course, now for questions. And yes, and that's it. We are recording this, and this will be then on our channel, I think. So I think that's it. We have a very special talk today, a joint talk by two members of our center, Maria Chiara Leonetti, who's a biologist, and Silvia Bonfanti, who's a physicist. And then they will talk today about how chromatin and cytoskeletal tethering determine the nuclear morphology in progerin expression cells. So please, Maria Chiara, it's all yours.
So thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. As Fran already tells you, this is a two-voice seminar. This is my voice. I am Maria Chiara. I am a cellular and molecular biologist at the Environmental Science and Policy Department at the University of Milan. And today with me in this talk, we take part also Silvia Bonfanti, which is a physicist at the Physics Department at the University of Milan. For some of you, it may sound strange, this two-voice seminar, but for us, it's basically the normality, since Silvia and I are both members of the Center for Complexity and Biosystems, which is an interdisciplinary center at the University of Milan, mainly composed by biologists, mathematicians, physicists, and informatics that used to work together, integrating and sharing their expertise. Indeed, the research activity of the center concern different topics of both biophysical and biomedical interest, and ranges from complex data analysis to cancer to cell biologists to disorder material and so on and so forth. But in this talk, in particular, we will present you our last paper that basically concerns cell mechanics and chromatin. The main protagonist of this project is nuclear lamina. Nuclear lamina, as I already mentioned, is an evolutionary well-conserved cell structure present in all the animal cells. It is basically a complex meshwork of two kinds of filamentous protein called lamins that cover all the nuclear inner surface of the nucleus. Because of this peculiar architecture, this structure act as a nuclear scaffold, providing cells basically mechanical stability. But in addition to the structural role, nuclear lamina is also actively involved in several important cell functions, since it is able to interact with a huge number of molecules. For instance, nuclear lamina can bind chromatin, and because of this interaction, is actively involved in gene expression regulation, but it is also in contact with many transmembrane proteins that, in the case of nuclear pore, for instance, mediates nuclear communication with the extra nuclear compartment, or in the case of some link complex, directly mediates nucleus to cytoskeletal coupling. The interest for this structure has grown because the discovery of several mutations in the gene encoding for lamin A protein, that is one of the main components of nuclear lamina. I just show you in this slide a few examples of this mutation in gray boxes. One of the interesting things is that all these mutations occurring on lamin A gene are responsible for the onset of a class of pathology that is known as laminopathies. Among these, Among these mutations, one of the most interesting is the one that occurs at the C-globular domain in the red square, that is responsible for the onset of a well-known laminopathy called progeria or Hutchinson-Gilford progeria syndrome. Progeria, as I already mentioned, is a laminopathy, is a rare fatal genetic disorder due to the mutation that I show you in the previous slide. This mutation leads to the production, basically, of a truncated form of wild-type laminae, and is called progerin. The disease is mainly characterized by two peculiar features that are, as shown in this slide, accelerating aging of the affected people and nuclear morphology alteration of the patient with bleb-like protrusion. While the genetic origin of progeria has been clarified in the last year, the precise mechanism that leads to change in nuclear morphology is somehow still unknown. There is, however, an increasing awareness that the mechanical properties of the nucleus are not only determined by the properties of nuclear lamina itself, but that the mechanical properties of the nucleus rather depend on the tethering existing between nuclear lamina and chromatin on the coupling existing between nuclear lamina and cytoskeleton. So basically, we ask ourselves three questions that are, does progerin, so does the alteration in nuclear lamina affect somehow chromatin and lamin tethers? Does the progerin present, so alterated nuclear lamina affects lamina cytoskeletal tethers? And if yes, how these impact on cell morphology and function? We tried to answer this question, adopting an interdisciplinary approach again that combines wet lab experiment and simulation. So now I will present you the experimental part of the work following that we'll talk about the in silico experiment that we did on this topic. So let's start with the experimental part of the work. In principle, the best strategy to study the effect of nuclear lamina alteration on cell mechanics is to directly use progeria patient derived cells. Unluckily, these cells that are obtained from the patients are not so, let me say, researcher friendly, since they are obtained from very rare biopsy samples. And when in culture, have a very slow rate of doubling, most of them are senescent and cannot be maintained in culture for more than just a couple of passages. Thus, to overcome the limitation posed by the use of cells directly derived from patient, we develop an inducible cellular model of mutated laminae, an inducible cellular model of progerin. And briefly, what we did, we cloned the progerin protein under the control of a drug-inducible promoter. What does it mean? It means that in the absence of doxycycline, that is the promoter activator, our promoter is inactive, thus we don't have the expression of progerin. By contrast, in the presence of doxycycline in our cell culture medium, the promoter is activated and thus promote the transcription and the expression of progerin in our cellular model. One of the main pros of this of our approach is that we can induce the expression of progerin in a drug dose dependent manner, as you can see in the Western blot in this slide, where increasing the concentration of the drug in the cell culture medium, we obtain a higher expression of progerin in our cellular model. Once built the model and checked for progerin proper induction and make all of our internal control, experimental control, interestingly, the first thing that we noticed just by looking at our cells under the microscope was that cells in the presence of the drug that induce the expression of progerin show an evident alteration of nuclear morphology. Indeed, as shown better in this slide, in this image, control cells, so cells that are not exposed to the drug, has a normal regular nuclear shape, while nuclei of cells under progerin expression induction display a nuclear phenotype that is very similar to those, to that of progeria patient directly derived cells. At this point, we perform some measurement that tells us something about more about nuclear morphology. And what we did is to measure the number of blebs and the local curvature, both in our cellular model, treated or untreated with the drug that induced the expression of progerin, and also in fibroblasts directly derived from a progeria patient and an healthy control. All the analysis and all the measurements basically tells us that all these different quantitative measures basically confirm that nuclei of both our cellular model that is expressing progerin and cells directly derived from the patient display highly significant alteration with respect to their control, confirming that our cellular model can faithfully recapitulate the main morphological feature of the nuclei of progeria patient cells. Okay, as previously reported, nuclear lamina is a part of a complex network of protein. And in particular, the first thing that we did is to focus our attention on two fundamental lamin interactors that are the link complex and enerin. Specifically, the link complex is composed by SAM1 protein and esprin. SAM1 is a transmembrane protein that on one side is able to bind to nuclear lamina and associate with enerin, and on the other side can bind to giant nesprin that in turn take contact with the cytoskeleton. Enerin, on the other hand, is a nuclear envelope transmembrane protein that on one side bind directly to lamin A, associate with SAM1 protein, and on the other side of the of its part is basically able to interact directly with chromatin. So, to study the role of progerin induction in the tethering existing between lamins and chromatin, the first thing that we did in this case is to investigate the levels of expression of both SAM1 and enerin in our cellular model by the Western blot technique. As shown in this slide, neither SAM1 nor enerin levels of expression changes significantly in dependence on the expression of progerin. So the presence of progerin does not affect the levels of expression of these two transmembrane proteins. Following, we always wanted to verify whether progerin presence may impact on the physiological nuclear interaction that occur between nuclear lamina and enerin, and the physiological interaction that occur between nuclear lamina and SAM1. To do this, we performed the proximity ligation assay. What is it? Proximity ligation assay is an assay that basically allows the detection and the visualization of protein interaction. Briefly, what we did, we used two different primary antibodies, one against on lamins and the other against SAM1 protein or enerin protein. These primary antibodies were in turn conjugated with two different proximity ligation probes. When protein of interest, so in our case, lamina and SAM1 or lamina and enerin, were closer than 40 nanometers, the probes were close enough to interact and give us a result, a fluorescent spot, each representing a lamina enerin or a lamina SAM1 interaction point. Once detected, this protein-protein interaction, we also quantified this interaction counting the number of fluorescent dots per cell in our cellular model. As shown, while the interaction occurring between SAM1 and lamina is unaffected by progerin presence, by progerin induction, you can observe a significant reduction in the interaction that occurs between enerin and lamina upon progerin induction, meaning that progerin expression strongly impact on nuclear lamina chromatin tethering that is mediated mainly by enerin. Okay. Next step, we move a step further, and we decided to focus our attention on lamina and cytoskeletal coupling. This coupling, as you can easily understand looking at this slide, is mainly mediated by other two key players that are Nesprin 2, also called the giant Nesprin, and Pashin here in yellow. In particular, Nesprin 1 is a giant protein that can associate with the inner nuclear membrane, where it binds to some one protein, while it can also associate with the outer membrane, exposing the terminal and terminal domain towards the cytoplasm, where it combines cytoskeletal actin through the phosphorylated form of fascin. Okay. In the light of these, we thus investigated the possible impairment of this complex, so of the fascin Nesprin 2 complex in our cellular model. And again, the first thing that we did is to check the level of expression of both giant Nesprin and fascin and its phosphorylated form in our cellular model. As shown in the upper panel, the induction of progerin did not change the levels of expression of Nesprin 2. But on the other hand, if you look at the lower panels, we observe an increase in the expression levels of the phosphorylated form of fascin as progerin level of expression increase. Basically, our observation suggests that the expression of progerin enhances somehow the coupling between nucleus and cytoskeleton that is mediated by the phosphorylated form of the fascin and Nesprin increased interaction. In the wake of these results, we then decided to study what is the effect of the cytoskeletal activity on the nuclear envelope in the presence of progerin of the mutated form of lamin. To this end, we transiently transfect ELA cells with a green fluorescent progerin or with a green fluorescent lamin A wild type. After that, we then expose the cell to different drugs that are able to act to impair cytoskeleton activity. And in particular, we expose the cells to cytochalasin D, which is a drug able to stabilize acting depolymerization. We expose our cells to blebbistatin that is able to affect myosin activity. And finally, also we expose our cells to SMIF-H2 that is able to inhibit nucleation of actin polymerization. In particular, after each treatment, we put cells in a fresh grow medium, and we took a snapshot with the confocal microscope in the time lapse every 15 minutes after the treatment up to an hour. We also perform multiple zeta stack acquisition of our images, and these basically allow us to perform a three-dimensional reconstruction of the nuclear surface, of which these are just example. And from each time series of nuclear meshes, we basically computed the local displacement field that is, let me say, an indicator of nuclear deformation as function of time. Here we have our results, and as shown here, we have on the y-axis mean nuclear displacement, so our indicator of nuclear deformation. On the y-axis, the different time points considered. In gray, you will always find control cells. In green, cells treated with blebbistatin. In purple, cells exposed to SMIF. And in light blue, cells exposed to cytochalasin. As shown at first in panel B, what we can conclude from this result is basically that progerin overexpression, if we look at displacement field, leads to significantly larger time-dependent fluctuation in the nuclear envelope of progerin-expressing cells compared with cells that overexpress the wild-type form of the protein. Moreover, the treatment with all the drugs acting on the cytoskeleton showed significant difference in the presence of progerin. So what we can conclude for this experiment is basically that hindering cytoskeletal activity affects mainly progerin-expressing cells, reducing their nuclear surface, as if the nuclei of cells that express progerin are at the mercy of a cytoskeleton tug of wars, because these are more strongly coupled through Nesprin phosphofascin increased interaction to cytoskeleton. At this point, we move another step further, and we decide to investigate what are, at this point, the effect of progerin induction on two different fundamental cell functions that are cell migration and gene regulation. To study the impact of progerin expression on cell migration cell migratory capability, we perform the standard Wold-Dilling assay, both on progerin expressing cells and in control cells. At this point, we time-lapse imaged the Wold process and analyzed the images. We calculated the time evolution of the average position of cell front and velocity distribution. And as shown in the graph in the right part of the slide, both velocity distribution and cell front position over time appears altered by progerin induction, leading to a slower collective cell migration. Then, as anticipated, we also investigated the effect of progerin induction on gene regulation, since in particular it has been reported that nuclear lamina is able to directly interact with both polycomb repressor complex 1 and polycomb repressor complex 2. What are these? Polycomb repressor complex 1 and 2 are two multiprotein complexes, are very important epigenetic regulator of gene expression, and play a crucial role in gene silencing and gene silencing maintenance with different mechanisms. Using the same approach for the other protein, the first thing that we did is to check the level of expression of the main component of both the polycomb complexes in our cellular model. And as shown in this slide, we detect the presence of EZH1, SUTS12, RING1A, and BMI, while we cannot detect the presence of RING1B, which is another component of the polycomb repressor complex 2. Moreover, we detect we didn't observe any difference in levels of expression of all this protein in control cells in comparison with cells that are able to express progerin. Following that, to verify whether progerin presence may impact on physiological nuclear lamina polycomb complex interaction, we carried out again a proximity ligation assay in our cellular model, but this time in order to detect interaction that can occur between lamin A and BMI1, which is one of the main components of polycomb repressor complex 1, and to detect the interaction occurring between lamin A and SUTS12 that belongs to polycomb repressor complex 2. As shown, again, we detect the interaction, we quantified the interaction, and as shown in the left panel, while lamin A BMI interaction is unaffected by progerin induction, the interaction that occurs between SUTS12 and lamin A is significantly changed by the presence of progerin, suggesting that the presence of progerin influences proper nuclear lamina polycomb repressor complex 2 interaction and thus may have an effect on gene regulation. So, just to sum up the first part, our experimental result can be summarized saying basically that We built an inducible cellular model of progerin that faithfully recapitulates and helps to shed lights on the molecular mechanism underlying nuclear morphology alteration that occurs in the presence of the pathology. Moreover, nuclear alteration of the nuclear lamina that in our case is represented by the presence of progerin can effectively affect proper lamin chromatin tethering and may have also a strong effect on lamin cytoskeletal coupling, also influencing somehow fundamental cell functions such as cell migration and gene regulation. Now I will leave the virtual stage to Silvia.
Okay, thank you, Maria. Now I share the screen. Maria, you should stop sharing so I can share the screen. Okay. One second. Okay, can you see my screen now? Okay, so now let's see the result of the numerical simulations. So to shed light on the nuclear alteration observed in patients with affected by progeria, we interpret our experimental results obtained in the lab with our cellular model, where the progeny expression was induced, implementing a computational model of the cell nucleus. Our motivation is once again to understand the role played by the lamin chromatin and by the lamin cytoskeleton on the nuclear shape morphology and in the cellular functions. Our numerical model is coarse-grained. Indeed, the intention is to capture the mechanical properties of the essential nuclear components without resorting to detailed modeling of their structure. Therefore, the model includes explicitly chromatin fibers, the nuclear shell, and the cytoskeleton. In addition, we have seen before that the mechanical coupling between these elements is mediated by a set of key proteins which act as connectors. And therefore, we introduced in the model two sets of elastic tethers between the lamin shell and the internal chromatin fibers, and also between the lamin shell and the external cytoskeleton. This is a sketch of our simulation system. We consider a discretized model for the cell nucleus composed by a flexible shell, which is reported here in orange, representing the nuclear envelope and the lamina. We model the chromatin fibers inside, the blue beads, following previous coarse-grained polymer models that have been successfully used to study chromatin organization in the nucleus. And finally, the external set of randomly distributed green beads represent the cytoskeletal elements. The dotted lines indicate the tether between the lamin shell and the internal chromatin fibers in black, and between the lamin shell and the external cytoskeleton. Cytoskeletal element in magenta. But now let's see the details of the model. The nuclear envelope is initially modeled as a triangulated sphere with around 10,000 nodes that you can see here, these orange beads. Each node is treated as a particle in molecular dynamics simulation, and the cost of stretching the shell is implemented by coupling each node by linear spring to its neighbors. Instead, the cost of bending the shell is described by coupling each triangular plaquette, as we can see here, to its neighbors using an harmonic angle between the plaquette. The elements of the cytoskeleton are modeled with 100 randomly placed external beads. And to simulate the cytoskeletal activity, each element follows an oscillatory motion with random frequencies and amplitudes. Finally, to model the chromatin, we model as a set of polymers made by monomers that you can see here, and the monomers are coupled with linear and angular springs. To avoid that the chromatin overlaps monomers also interact with a Lennard-Jones interaction, and to prevent the chromatin polymers to pass outside the shell, we also implement a Lennard-Jones repulsion between the chromatin and the nuclear envelope. The initial chromatin configuration is first relaxed, and then the system is brought to thermal equilibrium Afterwards, the nuclear envelope and the cytoskeleton are added to the simulation. Now, let's see the details of the tethers. So the coupling between the nuclear envelope and the elements of the cytoskeleton is realized via springs that connect randomly selected points on the nuclear lamina with a spring constant K cyto. The coupling between the lamina and the chromatin is realized also via springs, but only involving the monomers that are near to the envelope. However, for further details about the numerical parameters, we invite you to refer to the paper. Furthermore, an essential feature of our model is the presence of spatial domains in the lamina, which are bounded by domain walls. Indeed, the existence of spatial domains was demonstrated experimentally in this paper, where it has been found, as we can see in this sketch, that in wall-type nuclei, the lamin filaments have no preferred orientation, while instead in progeria nuclei, the lamin filaments are ordered within distinct domains. Therefore, we took this information into account in our simulation and introduced lamin domains in the model by defining domain boundaries, which are more bendable than the domains, so the nuclear shell folds more easily along this region. We can observe the domain walls here on the surface of the sphere in our initial configuration in black. So now, as a first task, let's see and focus on the reproduction of the morphology of blebs in silico. And specifically, let's focus on the chromatin lamin tethers. We first consider the case here in which chromatin lamin tethers are randomly distributed on the nuclear envelope, but we don't implement the nuclear domains in the simulation for the moment. So basically, the bending parameter is the same on each point of the lamina. And as shown here, while the surface deformation in the nuclear lamina are present, no distinct bleb is observed. And even if we vary the density of tethers and their stiffness, we see nuclear alterations, but these are in the forms of crumples that are qualitatively very different from the bleb observed in the experiments. As a next step, therefore, we introduce the lamin domains in the model, as I explained before, by defining domain boundaries that we can see with low bending stiffness and keep the uniform distribution of the lamin chromatin tethers. But again, we don't observe blebs and only we record minor alterations. So now, recalling that our experiment showed a net reduction of the lamin chromatin tethering when the progerin was expressed, specifically emerin, and knowing that the lamin filaments are ordered within domains in the progeria nuclei with respect to the wall-type nuclei, we now assume that the chromatin-lamin coupling occurs exactly at the domain wall boundaries, where the lamin organization is less ordered. Indeed, only when we attach exclusively the tethers at the lamin domain boundaries, we are able to recover the nuclear shapes with bleb similar to those found in the experiments. As we can see here, so these computational results therefore show that the local organization of the chromatin lamin tethers is the key factor that control the bleb formation. And in particular, in this simulation, we can observe how the lamin domain walls are pulled inside the nucleus by the chromatin tethers, creating the folds required for the bleb formation. Chromatin lamin tethers reported as blue segments here are exactly placed at the domain walls, as you can see. And on the right, instead, we see the tethered chromatin filaments inside the transparent nuclear lamina with different colors. So after having established that our computational model is able to reproduce the morphological alteration of progeria nuclei, we decided to use the model to better understand why the nuclear fluctuations are enhanced when the progerin is overexpressed, as we observed in our experimental model. Indeed, we saw that progerin overexpression is associated with larger nuclear fluctuations, leading to an increased fascin phosphorylation, which represent an enhanced coupling between the cytoskeleton and the nuclear shell. We simulated the cytoskeletal contraction, as explained before. And we incorporate we vary the strength of the coupling between the cytoskeleton and the nuclear shell. We mimic the increase of fascin phosphorylation with increasing the tethering stiffness K cyto. We therefore studied the fluctuations of the nuclear shape induced by cytoskeletal activity, computing the standard deviation of the local displacement as a function of K cyto, in close analogy with the experimental analysis that we did before. As we can see in this plot, the stronger is the cytoskeletal coupling, the larger are the fluctuation here. And this is in good agreement with the experimental results indicating that the progerin overexpression is associated with larger nuclear fluctuations. Finally, this is the movie of the fluctuations of the nuclear shape induced by cytoskeletal activities, where red and blue indicates respectively positive and negative displacement. Therefore, in conclusion, altogether, our Teton model and in silico model highlight the important role played by chromatin and nuclear tethering in determining the nuclear morphology and fluctuations. And this has important implication for the progeria syndrome. This is the reference to our work that has been accepted on Biophysical Journal and will be online from May 5. We would like to thank the author and you for your attention.